In part two of this course, I talked about using the static keyword for creating constant member variables. Now, normally I would have gone into detail about how this works, but the truth is that the inner workings of the JVM's various memory spaces is something which even many senior Java developers do not have a clear understanding of. To make things even more ambiguous, these details change depending on which version of the JVM you happen to be using. So please keep in mind for the rest of this lesson that I am going to be focusing mostly on the practical usage of the static keyword, and the theory I do give you is going to be both simplified and generalized, while still somewhat accurate. If you recall from earlier lessons, we use the new keyword when we want to create a new object from a class in memory space. One thing which took a while for me to really understand is that a class itself is not an object, but rather it is used by the JVM as a set of instructions or blueprints for building an object. After the Java compiler creates a bytecode version of a class, such as Sudoku game, the JVM places said bytecode class in a distinct location in memory. This area in memory holds what we will call class data. Anytime the JVM needs to create an object, such as when we use the new keyword, it will look at the class data and use it to build an object in a different portion of memory space. The main idea you need to understand about the static keyword is that static variables are stored in the same space as the class data. Instance variables, the non-static ones, are stored with the object that they are associated with. There are several consequences to the fact that these static variables are stored with the class data instead of with the object, but the most important one has to do with the ratio of objects relative to static variables. There only exists one copy of a given static variable for any number of objects associated with it. For example, we can create 500 Sudoku game objects and they will all be sharing that same static variable. That is why in section 3 I told you to be very careful with non-final static variables. If they are not final, they are a prime example of shared mutable state. As for static methods, you can probably guess that they are stored in the class data as well. But actually, all methods for a class are stored in the class data, so the distinction here is less important. Well, I have some more news which you are not going to like. If you search this topic online, you will find entire blogs dedicated to convincing how static methods are evil incarnate because they are difficult to test or they are not considered object-oriented programming. Again, I could get into an extraordinary amount of theory here on those two points, but I think that is enough theory for one lesson. Let us look at a few examples and we will try to draw some conclusions from them. A good hint for when to use static methods comes from the Java Math class from stdlib. This class is full of static methods and they mostly follow a simple pattern which we can use as a guideline. They just take in some data, usually a primitive, and return some result in a deterministic way. They may delegate to other static methods. They can do all of this work without relying on instance variables, that is, the non-static variables associated with an object as opposed to the class itself. A common prescription for static methods is that they work great for utility methods. I find this word utility to be a little bit too generalized to be useful, so the above guidelines I gave are an attempt at answering the question of what constitutes a utility method. Using my own definitions for a moment, I find very often that computation logic, which I consider the Java Math library to be representative of, often makes sense to model as static functions. For example, if you look into the computation logic package of the Sudoku app, you will see that the classes responsible for building, validating, and solving a Sudoku puzzle, represented as a two-dimensional array, are full of static methods. In this case, rather than using classes as a means of describing objects, I am actually using classes as a means of grouping together different functions based on what kind of problems they are concerned with. As mentioned before, static methods represent a somewhat different approach to the object-oriented paradigm. They are a great candidate for solving problems which correspond to mathematical logic, such as manipulating types like primitives, arrays, and strings. However, because they exist independent of objects, they can cause us to lose some of the benefits which we gain by working with an object-oriented language. As for the argument that they present problems for testing, that idea is actually entirely dependent on how you use them. In any case, we will worry about this after I have introduced the topic of testing.